Hi, my name is Teresa Welborn, and I'm the senior pastor here at University UMC. Thanks again for being in worship with us. In today's service, we continue our sermon series on creation care and climate justice. Indeed, through the years, we continue to learn more about the climate crisis. It can be overwhelming, but friends, let us in faith believe that the small things that we do can make a difference. I'm grateful for those who respond to natural disasters in ways that lend a helping hand. And I give thanks for the many of you in the congregation who continue to educate yourselves about the ways that your life practices can lead us to take better care of God's earth. Friends, this day, as we begin worship, may the words of young climate activist Greta Thunberg inspire us and challenge us. She shares these words. She says, "All we have to do is wake up and change." May it be so. Let us join together with AB as they lead us in song. As we turn to the scriptures, again, we are looking at a sermon series on creation care and climate justice. In last week's sermon, we focused and centered on the theme of wildfires, and today it will be on floods. So it probably doesn't surprise you that you will hear part of the Noah Ark story. But before we get there, I want to share these words from Psalm 46. May they be words that give you hope this day. Psalm 46 reads like this. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth should change, though the mountains shake in the heart of the sea, though the waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble with its tumult. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of the city, it shall not be moved. God will help it when the morning dawns. Be still and know that I am God. I am exalted among the nations. I am exalted in the earth. God is with us. God is our refuge. And then these words from Genesis chapter 9. God said, "This is the sign of the covenant that I make between me and you and every living creature, all for all generations. I have set my bow in the clouds, and it will be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. When I bring clouds over the earth and the bow is seen in the clouds, I will remember my covenant that is with me and you and every living creature of all flesh. And the waters shall never again become a flood to destroy all flesh. When the bow is in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is on the earth." God said to Noah, "This is the sign of the covenant that I have established between me and all flesh that is on the earth." The word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. So a story of Noah and all the animals. This story may, like me, take you back to your childhood. I remember in particular, my mother had a storybook about Noah and the ark. And whenever she would read it to me, I would sit right next to her. And at this one part, it would talk about the animals going into the door of the ark as they boarded, and they would go in two by twos. And then there got to be the point where it talked about the elephants, and it said the elephants had to squeeze to get through the door. And I always remember my mother would hug me tight and draw me close to her when she read that part. And you might also have your own childhood memories or memories of children in your life who have either pictures or storybooks of Noah and the ark. I think so many of our churches in the children's wing or in the preschools, they have pictures of the animals in the ark painted on the walls. Indeed, at first glance, this tale seems to be like a simple children's story about animals. But of course, we know better. We know more of the story. We know about how in this story, we hear of a God who has become fed up with humanity, so tired of humans. Humans who have strayed far from that idyllic Garden of Eden when all was peaceful and loving. Then as the stories in Genesis continued to unfold, we saw at every turn that humans were bent on returning to chaos and destruction. There is murder, there is deceit, there is revenge. In today's world, we only need to open the newspaper, right? To find stories reminding us that humans today, we fail to embrace the things of love and peace. It was in seminary that we were made to analyze this text alongside another ancient myth, the Gilgamesh flood epic. There are also other similar stories out there about a big flood event that took place, and some scholars go on to share their perspective that such stories like Noah's Ark are an attempt to explain and make sense of that flood event. Also, the story of Noah's Ark was birthed in the period when ancient Near Eastern religions would often depict the gods at war. In fact, lightning bolts in the sky were often seen as a metaphor for the arrow. As we consider all of this and wonder what it means for us today, it is understandable that we would wrestle with this story. It is even understandable to push back against an understanding of a God who would destroy most every living thing in order to start again. But this morning, I invite you to consider how we might at times have the heart of God. That's right. You know, here in the church, in lots of churches, we often shy away from seeing ourselves like God. And I guess that's understandable. It can be heretical at times to assume that we are omnipotent. That is heretical. But there might be other ways that we are called to love like God and to even feel like God. We look at a story from the scripture and we are asked, where do we see ourselves in it? Are we the sheep? Are we the disciple who doubts? Are we the prodigal child or the older sister? But when I was growing up, never did a pastor ask me to consider how I might be like God. Now, again, that might sound heretical, but the very Bible itself tells us that we were created in the image. And more to the point, I will admit that I can understand God's decision to just wipe the slate clean, to just try and start again. After all, have you ever worked on a project and felt like that? We might see children building a tower with blocks and they get discouraged because it isn't quite what they had in mind, and so out of frustration they just knock it all down. Or a student working on an exam, writing an assignment and crumpling up the paper out of frustration, tossing it into the trash can. Well, here God wants to start over. Friends, I wonder if you're like me when you face the reality of climate change, do you wish we could start over? Maybe seeing that Cher song, If I Could Turn Back Time. Maybe next time we could prevent it all from getting so bad. Maybe temperatures wouldn't be rising quite so drastically. Maybe we could pass policies that would prevent us from getting where we are today. Maybe there would be more coral reefs. There was in the news a lot this week. If only we could start again, right? But of course we can't. This is the world we have. And the realities before us are, well, our reality. Temperatures are rising, and therefore sea levels are rising as ice melts. Warm air holds more water, and then the rainfalls get heavier. Warmer oceans also mean creatures are in danger of finding the food that they need. God is making promises to never destroy the earth again. How about us? Here's another way I think we can be like God, and it's a lesson in what to do with our regret. Instead of more destruction, we make a covenant to love and care for the entire earth, including all of its creatures on the land and above in the sky and in the waters. A couple of closing thoughts that I want you to consider. First, I want you to be inspired by what is going on in our wider denomination. Yes, that's right. Some of us are aware that this next week is our general conference in Charlotte, North Carolina. It's a time to meet and vote on a variety of legislative topics. I will be following, and I will seek to share with you in the Friday note and in other places. I do feel optimistic that this body of voters will finally be able to move us forward in removing the harmful language from our book of law called the Book of Discipline. But of course, no matter what, we here at University UMC, we will remain steadfast in our commitment to the inclusion of all LGBTQIA+ persons into the full life of the church. There is additional news at General Conference that I am following and I wanted to share with you. And part of what I have learned is that leaders are hoping other parts of our social principles are changed, including a section that pertains to creation care and climate justice. For years, there has been a section entitled The Natural World. And after conversations with people in a variety of countries, remember, the United Methodist Church is global in nature, there was an aha, namely, the old language that tended to perceive humanity as somehow apart from creation was needing to be revised. Here's what one leader wrote. They said the old language talks about our responsibility for the natural world as though we are not a part of it. In the new document, we are setting ourselves more within the community of all creation to show our interdependence with the earth. They go on. The community of all creation section begins by describing the dire threats creation is facing at this time, including climate change, overdevelopment, and use of unsustainable energy sources. The document then calls on Christians to adopt more sustainable and just practices. The revised social principles also acknowledge the ways unjust environmental policies touch other social concerns, such as racism, classism, and the historic mistreatment of Indigenous persons. Friends, our global denomination is not perfect, but there are good people doing incredible work all throughout it. In a similar way, the subject of climate change can be overwhelming, but there are good people doing incredible work all throughout our community, including many of you. Believe. I want you to believe that the small things you are doing make a difference. One of my favorite children's poets is Shel Silverstein, and he has a poem that goes like this. All the shoulda, coulda, wouldas ran away and hid from the one little did. In other words, yes, we may live with guilt and regret when it comes to the overwhelming topic of climate change, but the key is to do something. We know what to do. There is so much education out there. Cut down on single-use plastics. That's one thing we can do. All the shoulda, coulda, wouldas ran away and hid from the one little did. The doing is important, but just as important is that word little. Start in small ways, commit to a journey, and take your cues from the children in your life. They teach us so much when it comes to caring for creation. Think about it. As children, the animals were our friends. We wore them on our clothes. We had stuffed animals of every type of creature. I had bed sheets with animals all over them. But as we grow older, we move on to celebrities and we are enamored with other things. Maybe the story of Noah's Ark is about children and a genuine love for all animals after all. Because at the heart of this story is a message of God's love and God's hope to children of all ages, to let them know that in the worst of chaos, God is with us. We are not alone, and God is love. Amen. As we go to God in prayer this day, friends, we do so acknowledging the members of our community who are in need of our continued prayers for healing in their life as they recover from either surgeries or being ill or hospital visits. We also lift up the caregivers in our community who are giving love and compassion and service to special people in their lives. We pray for our larger world, for places especially where there is harm and violence, that people would be kept safe and that there would be leaders who work for peace, truly peace in this world. As United Methodists, we also lift up our denomination and the work that is taking place in General Conference for all of the delegates, for those voting, and for the spirit of wisdom and love to be made strong in them. As we pray, I want to share this prayer that I found as we look towards Earth Day. It's called an Earth Day Confession. May we pray. O God, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen, you place us in your creation and you command us to care for it. Your works declare glory and splendor, and you call us to praise and reverence. Where we have degraded or destroyed earth's bounty, forgive us. Where we have taken beauty and majesty for granted, have mercy upon us. Where we have become estranged from the creatures with whom we share this planet, grant us your peace. Renew us in the waters of baptism. Refresh us with the winds of your spirit and sustain us with the bread of life. In the name of Jesus Christ and for the sake of the new creation, we pray. Amen and amen.
This is God's wondrous world, and to my listening ears, all nature sings and round me rings the music of the spheres. This is God's wondrous world.
At this time in our worship service, we come to a time of offering ourselves to God. I continue to give thanks for your generosity that enables us to be a place of unconditional love and justice in action here in the heart of Austin. This day, I also give thanks for the many volunteers who keep our ministries going, such as our Open Door Feeding Ministry and our children's ministries. If you are worshiping online and are new to our community, I would encourage you to find our website so that you can learn more about different opportunities, and never hesitate to reach out to myself or Pastor Earl if you have need for a listening ear and want to connect with a pastor or want to learn more about our church. Again, we're glad you're here. Again, also thank you to the many people who give of their financial gifts so that we can continue our work. And if you are feeling led to give financially, you can go to our website, to that donate button, and find ways to give. And now, friends, as you go forth this day, I pray that you would take these words with you. It's a benediction for Earth Day, written by Marin Tarabassi. And it goes like this. May God bless and keep in the ground the roots of old forests, the bulbs of next year's flowers and fossil fuels, hallowed resting places of trees that clap their hands, and creatures of the sea that sported in the morning of the shining face of God. And may God lift up the light of a loving countenance upon you who care for this earth from this time forth and the children's evermore. Amen.